Hey, everybody. Welcome to Village Church Online, wherever you are watching this from. We're really glad you're part of this church, a part of this service, a part of everything that God's doing among us. Pretty crazy. I was just thinking back to the video we showed at Easter Sunday, 42 baptisms. Congratulations to all of you. It's pretty special. And I was thinking about that because the text we're talking about today, it leads there. So if you got a Bible, John chapter 2, right at the end of 2, a couple of verses, and then in John chapter 3, which is one of the most famous conversations ever in the entire Bible. Some of the most important stuff in the whole Bible is in this conversation we're about to enter into, at least the beginning of it with our time today. So glad you're among us. Let me start this way. You guys ever get into like the JFK conspiracy theory stuff and kind of read websites and about, you know, I was exposed to it when I was probably about 11. My brother said, "Hey, JFK," I started researching all of this stuff. And, one of the mysteries about that, whole day, and obviously there's many theories about what was happening, November 22nd, 1963, beautiful, bright day in Dallas, Texas. And he's going along on his motorcade, and of course he gets shot. And there's a guy, and I want to show you this guy. He's standing here. He has been called the Umbrella Man, all right? I guess people, you know, aren't that creative. And so this is the Umbrella Man. And the Umbrella Man, you can't really tell because there's a post here or something, but this is his umbrella, and this is the post for the umbrella, and he's holding it. He's got a hat on and a suit on. He's standing here, and obviously, you know, photography, this is probably from this Zapruder film or some film at the time, but it's not as clear, but you can see the day he's holding a umbrella on the brightest day the Dallas, Texas has ever seen, warm day in November, and he's got an umbrella. He's the only person around with an umbrella, and so there's lots of theories about this. The theory is that he's hitting him with darts. He's hitting JFK with darts in order to make him sleepy so that people can shoot him. There's a theory that he's actually signaling other shooters to take second and third shots with the umbrella. And so there was this mystery for many, many years about what is the Umbrella Man doing? And recently, people have actually realized that what he was doing was he was part of a group of people who held umbrellas in different settings that were political protests or whatever, that were protesting something to do with the Cuban War, the Day of Pigs, and there was a battle there, and certain amount of U.S. soldiers had lost their lives in the Bay of Pigs invasion, and they held umbrellas because their whole critique was a failure of the American government to provide umbrella cover during that battle, and so they wanted to symbolically hold up an umbrella to say, hey, hey, JFK, look at me, you failed to actually do well at the Bay of Pigs invasion. Americans died because of it, and this umbrella is like a symbol of my protest to you, and you didn't provide the military necessary to actually do this well. So obviously, that's different. And in our lives, we tend to have moments where new information is coming in, but we kind of dig our heels in and we refuse to believe new things. I've shared this factual evidence with people and they've said, no, he's shooting them with darts, you know? And it's like, I want to hold on to the thing that's given me comfort for my whole life. And this tends to be what we do. And we see Jesus now entering into this conversation with Nicodemus that we're going to see, that is an upending of everything Nicodemus knew. And it's a challenge to all of us because we have to rethink and hold things lightly if we're going to get the truth to have it actually change our life. And we're going to see how Jesus interacts with a few different people now. The Gospel of John starts to pivot to a few different people, Nicodemus, and then the Samaritan woman in chapter 4, where we have Jesus confronting people. And the question is, will we allow Jesus to actually shift what we thought we knew and upend everything about our life? And it's a beautiful thing. But it starts introductorily with a very fascinating text. This is the end of chapter 2. If you're with us, last week we did the temple story. And right at the end of the temple story, it says this: "Now when he was in Jerusalem," so he's still there for the Passover at the end of the temple story, "at the Passover feast, many believed in his name when they saw the signs that he was doing." So remember, water and wine was his first sign, and now he's done some other things. He's done the temple, and many are believing in his name. Now this is fascinating. I believed in his name, right? So put yourself maybe in their shoes. They believed in his name because of the stuff we've seen. I believe in his name. I've become a Christian, you know, whatever you want to say. When they saw the signs he was doing, "I saw what you did and I've believed in you." Now here's where it starts to get scary. "But Jesus on his part did not entrust himself to them because he knew all people." Guys, just sit back for a second. Here's a fascinating piece of theology. In our culture, we tend to view humankind as like basically good. We're going to solve our social ills by finances, by education, by building hospitals, by doing social work. We're going to actually solve everything. The problem with that is the Bible's basic understanding of humankind is that we're not all that good. We're going to end up being corrupt in some way. We're going to end up doing things out of narcissism and our own fallenness and our own idolatries, either systemically or as individuals. That will happen. Not to say we shouldn't try those things, but we shouldn't trust to them for salvation. Because as Christianity comes along, it says humankind actually is in it for themselves. There's a darkness. There's a reason you lie. There's a reason you steal a little bit or misrepresent yourself online or to people around you. There's all these little things that we do. And this little verse, he knew all people. So he refused to entrust himself to them. He's basically saying, listen, humankind, you're actually so messed up. There's a piece of me I'm not going to give myself fully into your hands because you're going to mess this up. Think about how we've seen this over and over again. Through Christianity. I know of churches, pastors, preachers who used to believe in the Bible, and now they've just rethought everything to the point where they don't believe the basics of Christianity anymore. Oh, there's no hell. Everyone goes to heaven when they die. Jesus isn't the only way. The Bible's not true. It's just a fairy tale. Jesus didn't really rise from the dead. It's just a metaphor. And this is why Jesus goes, I can't really entrust myself to you fully because you're going to hack it. You're going to mess it up. And so there's a separation a little bit. I mean, look at the later verse, verse 25, and needed no one to bear witness about man, for he himself, here's a haunting verse, knew what was in man. There's something about what's in us that's gonna mistake this thing. And even as God goes to the greatest of us, as we're gonna see in Nicodemus, the religious elite, the people who know the Bible the best, he can't really entrust himself to them either because he knows what's in man. There's no perfection there. There's still corruption. We see it in the last year. We've seen some of the most religious people, public figures, evangelists, pastors, scholars, that when we find out what's really going on in their life, they're actually pretty corrupt people. They're sinful people. They're people who are into all kinds of things sexually or money or whatever it is. And we realize there's a reason that the Bible looks at humankind and says, you actually need saving. I know what's in you. You don't fool me. Isn't that scary? You get to fool everybody else around you. You get to fool everybody on social media that looks at your beautiful pictures and your perfectly orchestrated lasagna or whatever you've got. But I know what's in you in the dark when no one's looking. I know. And that's why D.A. Carson, who's a scholar, said if our problem was political, God would have sent a politician. If our problem was entertainment at the core of our being, he would have sent an entertainer. If our problem was financial, he would have sent a financial advisor. But our problem was sin, so he sent a savior. This is what he's saying. Our problem is sin. That's why I know what's in you. I know what needs to be healed about you. I know what needs to be solved about you, whether you know it or not. It's fascinating. Are you open to rethink your life? If maybe you're not a Christian yet, or maybe you are and you just don't really think of yourself as sinful in the sense of, oh, God could have totally given himself to me. I'm a good guy. Are you ready to rethink? I'm reading a book right now called Think Again by Adam Grant. And he's this psychologist and he talks about the idea that we as people tend to find it really difficult to rethink anything. He says, what we tend to do when a new idea comes into our life is we play one of three roles. We play the preacher, the prosecutor, or the politician. The preacher protects sacred ideas. The prosecutor attacks others to win a case. And the politician seeks to win over an audience. And he says, even in the face of contrary data, we hesitate to rethink our life because of cognitive laziness and it's a threat to our identity. We favor the comfort of conviction over the discomfort of doubt. When it comes to our knowledge and our opinions, we often favor feeling, he says, over being right. Isn't that fascinating? New information will come in where you're supposed to rethink some data and you'll go with what you feel instead. This is the basic problem. as we face Jesus in one of the most well-known, famous stories of all time. He meets a man named Nicodemus. And now John pivots from chapter 2 to chapter 3. And of course, all those distinctions weren't there in the Bible. There's no chapter and verse breakups in the original language. It just keeps going. And I think that end of chapter 2 is a beautiful introduction. He knew what was in man. He couldn't fully entrust himself to what was in man. And now we're going to deal with the story of a man who has to deal with new data in order to rethink everything. His own salvation, God himself, his own identity. Are you willing to take that journey? Over the next bunch of chapters, it's going to be crazy. We're going to have to rethink everything about humankind, about our own identity, about what a human soul, spirit is, what it means to actually ever be saved. Everything's going to be rethought. And Jesus is going to come and he's going to go, everything we ever thought about this has been wrong. So here we go. Now there was a man of the Pharisees. So he's religious. He trusts in religion. He believes in God. He studies the Bible. He's well-versed. He teaches Sunday school, Saturday school. He's a scholar. He has half the Bible memorized. He knows what's going on. And his name is Nicodemus. He's a ruler of the Jews. He's not just a regular guy. He's a teacher. He's a leader among them. And here's what happens. This man came to Jesus by night. John never wastes words. He comes to Jesus by night because he doesn't believe yet. He needs to be converted still. He knows the Bible, but he doesn't know the new life that Jesus Christ is offering yet. And here's what's fascinating. Jesus is going to tell this man that his religious experience actually isn't enough to save him. His religious doctrine doesn't mean that he actually knows God. And I think that one of the things that we have to wrestle with in our modern situation right now is that there are people who may have hung around churches or believed some stuff at some point or had some doctrinal points, but they don't actually know God to the point where, in the end, I mean, you see a lot of this deconversion and deconstruction going on right now. And I talked about this last week too, but it keeps rising to the surface through these texts to the point where the Bible constantly is giving us an image that just because someone has some ideas about God doesn't mean they're going to make it to the end. And I'm not saying everybody rethinking their or understanding their faith or church structures or whatever isn't actually a Christian. I'm talking about there are people who start to go down that road who end up in places where they're not actually Christians anymore. In fact, there's people for all kinds of reasons, the Bible tells us, that they might start off well, but they don't actually get to the end. And we've said this constantly in our church, that it's easy to, any dumbo can get married. The question is, how's your marriage on the last day, not the first day? Not necessarily starting faith, but having a life where you're faithful to Jesus by the time your life ends. Martin Luther talking about this idea that people would actually come to faith in Jesus but wouldn't last until the end. He says this, that there is milk faith in the end. A young faith of such enthusiasm that it isn't actually focused on the gospel, it's focused on other things. And he says this, one writer has said this, scarcely 1 in 10 of those who enlist under Christ keep the purity of their faith to the end. Almost all fall away into corruption, are led astray by the teachers of false ideas, or they betray their faith altogether. Here's a group of people who focused on the miracles of Jesus. Jesus wouldn't entrust himself to them. Here's a religious person. He comes by night because he's just not sure yet. He's interested, but he's not sure yet. It's beautiful because at least he's willing to come and allow Jesus to bring him to the place wherever doubt he had, whatever things he doesn't know. One writer has said this, Nicodemus has been blamed for his timidity. If he felt it was dangerous to be seen in the company of Jesus, it was a bold thing to visit him at all. He went by night, but he went. Are we willing, in the midst of our doubts, in the midst of our wanderings, to go still and sit at the feet of Jesus and have him teach us, even if our ideas get shaken up? I remember when I first started coming to the church, I was the nag of the youth pastor because I would always ask questions. I was a questioning, I would constantly be coming and asking for clarification. This is where Nicodemus goes, of course. He starts to ask a whole bunch of questions. Look at verse 2. Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher from God, for no one else can do these signs that you do unless God is with him. Verse 4. How can a man be born when he's old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? He's curious. I was on a podcast the other day and someone went, you know, the one thing I've learned about you after listening to you for all these years, and they said something no one has ever told me in my life. They said, one of the definitive characteristics about you is you're curious. And I was like sitting there listening to them. I'm like, yeah, I got books all over my, I got a book on the economy. I got a book on global population decline. I got a book on, you know, this and this. And I'm like, yeah, I kind of want to know stuff. And I'm constantly trying to go be able to rethink what Jesus is putting in front of you. Is that part of our life at all? Now, there's another part of this where he comes to him at night because he's actually afraid, which is fair. Some of you might be afraid as you start to listen to Jesus, as he talks to you, as he makes you rethink your life. And the reason you're not coming to faith is not because you're smarter than everybody. It's because you're afraid of what your girlfriend's going to say about you. You're afraid of what your coworkers are going to say. You're afraid of what your parents might say. And so it keeps you at a distance from coming to Jesus and saying, teach me. I want to actually know some stuff. He's scared. But then the beautiful thing is there's courage. Once he meets Jesus, there's actually courage that becomes part of Nicodemus's life, that he becomes the kind of person he never would have become without Jesus. Let me trace down his story for you, because some of us, we look at the story of Nicodemus and go, oh boy, you know, he asks a bunch of questions and then what actually happens to him, because we don't hear from him again for chapters after this very important conversation. Here's the story in chapter 7 of John, verse 50. Nicodemus, who had gone to him before, and who was one of them, meaning one of the crowds of Pharisees, said to them, does our law judge a man without first giving him a hearing and learning what he actually does? That's chapter 7. Then in chapter 19, Nicodemus also, who earlier had come to Jesus by night, came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 75 pounds in weight. And he's taking Jesus' body after he's crucified to the grave. This is Nicodemus' story. He starts out afraid by night. 4 or 5 chapters later, he's among the rulers and he's saying, hey, let's hold it back on Jesus. And by chapter 19, he's actually carrying the body of Jesus to the grave. And the difference is he met Jesus. The cowardice, the fear, the timidity then translates into courage. And some of us are exactly there in our life. A spouse has left you and it's given you timidity in life where you just don't feel worthy anymore because of past mistakes. The internet's turned on you. The world has canceled you, whatever your situation is. People at work, people in your family, and you feel like you could never get a shot at this, a fair shot. You're someone who just wonders to themselves, am I always going to be that person? The scared person who comes by night and never really fesses up to it. 4 chapters later, you're someone standing among the crowd fighting for Jesus. 15 chapters later, you're someone bringing the body. Like, this is courageous stuff, giving your life potentially for this. And the difference is, he met him. He met him. He sat with him. He listened to him. And once you meet him, you're never the same. And so he asks this question, Rabbi, we know that you're a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him. Jesus answered him, truly, truly, I say to you. I mean, he calls him, look what he calls him, teacher. you and I know, once you follow the story, that Jesus is more than a teacher. Liberal Christianity tends to focus on Jesus as a teacher, but then they leave aside Jesus as Savior and God and someone who rose from the dead and walked on water and all that stuff's kind of that. Jesus' main thing is he's a teacher of ideas, and they hone in and stop where Nicodemus begins. Teacher, and then they leave that behind. Conservative Christianity tends to leave aside the teaching role of Jesus altogether and say Jesus is just a savior of our sins. He's, you know, fully God and fully man, and that's it. We don't look at him and go, my gosh, how is he actually functioning as teacher, teaching me about how to do relationships and money and sexuality and all these different things? And so both of these things need to be held together. And then he says, you're doing these remarkable signs. No one can do these remarkable signs. Don't we all want that said about us? Is your life such that anybody would say there's stuff that's remarkable about you? That there's these signs about your life that make you go, gosh, God must exist, and I don't want, like, are we open book to the bigger story about your life that gives people awe and makes them wonder? Like, do you share the stuff? Okay, the other day, I was trying to think of just a dumb example, but the other day, I went through the drive-thru of this particular place, and I'm in the drive-thru, and I full on get in the drive-thru, do my order, and then forget my wallet. Forgot my wallet. So I've already ordered, then I forget my wallet, and I say to the girl, and I'm like, I'm really sorry. I know I've already ordered, but I forgot my wallet. And she's like, oh, okay, just go through then. But now I'm stuck behind this car. So I'm like, I just need to get out now because I can't. There's someone behind me, and so now I like get up the thing, and then the lady's like, oh yeah, so you got blah, 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 this order. And she hands it to me, and I'm like, no, I can't, I forgot my wallet. She's like, yeah, I know, but it's already paid for. And I'm like, what do you mean it's paid for? She's like, well, the person paid for it that was ahead of you. And I said, oh, that's funny. So they must have heard me telling you that I didn't have my wallet. And she's like, no. It's because the person in front of them paid for theirs, so then they were trying to pay it back, so then they paid yours. And I'm like, what? How can you not believe in God right now? This is crazy. I'm stuck in it. What are the statistical odds? This is the first and only time this has ever happened in my life, and I needed it to happen. You got it. Come on. Even if you're a skeptic, you got to. There's something behind the veil, bro. Come on. Anyway, so, but do we live lives that make anybody go, they got stuff about them that's fascinating. And it means that maybe there's more than just nature. Maybe there's more than just circumstance. Maybe there's stuff. Nicodemus is saying, what's drawn me to you is these things about your life that are remarkable. And he says, God is clearly with you. Is this what people are saying about us right now? I'm just constantly looking into this going, are people saying this about me? Do they see this about me? Now, Jesus replies and he goes, Jesus answered him. So finally, Jesus is like, okay, can I talk now? Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, this is a core phrase, right? Born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. That's one of the most important verses in the entire Bible. It clarifies. It brings everything into focus. Unless a person is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Now, what does that mean? Okay, so first off, what's the kingdom of God? because let's not talk about how to get somewhere unless we want to go to that place. The kingdom of God in the Bible is the reign and the rule of God. John only uses this twice. In the Matthew, Mark, and Luke, they use it all the time. It's the reign and the rule of God, the shalom, the hope, the peace, the forgiveness of sin, life to the full in the Spirit, the power, the person of the Holy Spirit, us living in freedom, having hope, having eternal life, going to heaven when we die, having a kind of joy that transcends any circumstance in the present time. Being not only forgiven of sin, but the power, the reign and the rule of life, that we come into it in the present, and then we go, of course, when we pass away, into the presence of God. And the question is, have you put yourself under the rule and the reign of God? And he's saying, how do I actually get that? How do I understand? How do I get into this place where I get into the kingdom of God in the present and in the future? And Jesus says, you got to be born again. Now, what does that mean? Well, I think we've kind of hacked this idea. When we ultimately get into the kingdom, our life changes in such a way that the kingdoms of this world can't affect us the way they once did. I remember sitting in a house. We were having a conversation one time, and this one person was mad at me for something. And I was like, okay, we've got to deal with this kind of head on, one-on-one. What do we got? And they were bringing up stuff from 15 years ago. You didn't come to my wedding on time. You know, there was a hair, like whatever, like just crazy stuff, the stuff I couldn't even remember. And I'm just like, you know what? At the end of the day, you can not like me, but here's my identity. It's not about what you're saying about me. And some of you just need to hear this right now, because you started to believe things about you that the internet says about you, or people say about you, or family members, or whatever. The kingdom of God means that your citizenship has transferred out from the kingdoms of the world and the identities of the world, and now you are child of God. And I looked at them and said, look, I'm not going to let all this stuff come on me. I'm going to believe about me what the gospel says about me. I'm beloved in spite of me, not because of me, because of him, but in spite of me and whatever mistakes I've made, because the power of the reality of coming into the kingdom means I'm forgiven. And I'm not only forgiven in the past, I get to walk in the newness of life. Yes, with mistakes, of course, but understanding that people don't get to define my identity for you by my mistakes or the things I've done in the past and create shame in me. That's the way of religion. That's the way of humanism. That's the way of agnosticism, atheism, whatever it is. The kingdom of God is something different. There's a far different experiential reality in it. And that's why Nicodemus wants to go there. That's why all of us, the fundamental question is the kingdom of God. How do I actually get God in my life at all? And he says, in order to get that kind of life, both when you pass away one day and in the present, is he says, you need to be born again. Now, what does that mean? It's a terrible name, because it's the name used by people like, oh, I'm a born again. It's not a terrible name that Jesus, we've made it a terrible name. We've done things with it throughout history that people, they're like, are you a born again? I'm a born again. And they're the people out, you know, with the signs that are like, God hates all of you. And it's like, I think that, you know, we're, you know, 666 is Bill Gates and he's trying to, you know, and it's like this version of Christianity that's like the face palm. It's like God, you know, go back up to chapter 2, why he's not going to put, you know, himself in the hands of people. It's like, because he's up in heaven going, oh my gosh, this is really what we're doing now. This is the name. And you're going, I'm a born again. No, the purity of this is Jesus saying, you need to be born again. Meaning what? That the first birth isn't enough. You were born into a religious household. You were born the first time, naturally. But that doesn't get you eternal life. Just existing. That's the heresy of universalism. If you exist, you go to heaven when you die. Doesn't matter what religion you are. Doesn't matter where you live. Just the fact that you're born once is enough. And the fact that you're maybe a religious person. Like this is something that we try to teach my daughters, because I got three daughters and they're pastor's kids, right? And so what setup is that? It's I'm going to go to heaven because my daddy's a pastor. I'm going to go to heaven because I was born into a Christian home. And he's going, that's not enough. And I'm constantly, like we're watching, I was telling you last week, we're watching The Chosen, the TV show about Jesus right now. And I'm constantly having to be like, okay, this is their faith, not mine. This isn't me as teacher mode, right? So the other day we're like watching it, and like one of the Pharisees like says something like, well, that was the days of, you know, just like Judas Maccabeus. And I'm like, yes, kids, that's the Maccabean revolt of BC. And they're like, Dad, you're not making this fun. Right? This ain't teacher. And I'm like, oh, right, right, right. Because I'm like, they can't vicariously live their faith through me. These stories, this truth, this reality needs to become theirs, not mine. This is Jesus looking at him saying, you need to be born again. The first time isn't enough. This is like, not to use a terrible movie illustration, a classic pastor movie illustration of the Matrix in the 90s. And Morpheus looks at Neo. It basically says, you've been living in an empire your whole life. Take the pill. And when he takes the pill, he wakes up in this crazy, and he literally gets reborn. And he has to take the things out. He's in a weird alien world, and that's the real world. You can go on living your life in this world, and that just means you're born once. But if you want the actual reality, if you want the actual truth, if you want the, you got to get born again. You got to trust in me and believe in me. And once that happens, everything changes. Everything, the way you feel, the way you view the world. Your first birth isn't enough. It's super humbling because it gives the image of a child, right? Like, look at his response. It's such a great conversation. Nicodemus said, how can a man be born when he's old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? That's gross. When you're watching The Chosen, and they have this conversation in it, actually, he says, does my mom need to be born? Because rest in peace, she's dead, all right? I can't actually be born again because my mom's dead. I can't climb up into her womb again. This is getting crazy. There's something so humbling about this. He's saying, to ever really be saved, guys, you got to go back and become like a child again, a baby. Doesn't matter how smart you are. Doesn't matter how beautiful you are. It doesn't matter how much money you have, how successful you are. None of it can save you because you got to go back again and become nothing. Useless. Remember, you know, babies, human babies? You know when you study animals? Like, the animals get born and they're actually useful. Like you watch a giraffe. They're like walking around and the giraffe like pops out and the giraffe's like, and you kind of get somebody. You watch a whale and the thing starts swimming right away. Watch a human birth. You know, in the human, why? That baby's not cooked in there yet. They need to get out because their head is so big that they need to get through the birth canal. So our body pushes them out at 9 months. But the reality is we're not ready. We still need to cook in there. And so we come out and we're just, you know, you have baby, you know, useless to just sit there. I need you. Let me eat. Let me do, give me, you know, if you just don't pay attention to a human baby, that's not gonna be good. A mom could draft and walk away. Baby's going to figure it out. There's a uselessness. There's a full dependency on God in all things that Jesus says has to happen for you to ever experience salvation. That you come to the end of yourself and you go, I got to trust him fully. I'm sinful and I need to be reborn because my natural state can't get me into the presence of God. Augustine put it this way. The problem with humanity is not that we sin, but that we are in a state of sin that needs a comprehensive solution. That's the problem. And that's what being born a second time or being born from above versus below actually gives you. And it means that we are not our past mistakes. We are not our past failures. They get washed away. A fresh start actually happens. Herman Bavinck, who's a theologian, he puts it this way, and it's beautiful. He says, God lays aside his wrath in light of Jesus' cross, changes his disposition towards the sinner, forgives the transgressions, and admits him again to his presence and fellowship. And the forgiveness, and I need some of you just need to hear this right now. The forgiveness is so perfect that it can be called a blotting out, Isaiah 43, or a casting of the sins into the depths of the sea, Micah chapter 7. The atonement obliterates the sin so completely that it is as if they never were committed. It banishes wrath and causes God's face to shine upon his people in fatherly favor and goodwill. It's like your sins were never committed because you get born a second time. A full, fresh start. The failures, the mistakes, the things you've done in the past. Jesus, through him and the Spirit, you get a new start. That's the whole point. But not only that, you get power for the present life in a way you could never imagine. Look what else Jesus says. Verse 5, after he's asked this, do I need to crawl back up into my mom and be born again? And he's like, guy, it's a metaphor. He says this, Jesus answered, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. Now, there's all kinds of debate about what Jesus is really meaning here. One part of the debate is he's talking about baptism, that of course we need the Holy Spirit, which is an introduction of a crazy idea that he hasn't talked too much about yet. They'll talk about it in a sec. But we need water baptism and to be spiritually converted and born again. I John the Baptist earlier in the book said, I will baptize with water, but Jesus with the Holy Spirit. So maybe there's some of that here. We love baptism as a church. We just did 42 baptisms a few weeks ago, showed that at Easter. We've had 2,000 people that have been baptized in the last 11 years, which is like, if that's all that ever happened, if that was our contribution to the kingdom, I could die a happy man. 2,000 baptisms and millions given to global mission partners and helping people out of sex trafficking. I mean, just crazy, amazing, unbelievable things that God, by his Spirit, has chosen to do among us because of you, because you've been changed. That kind of, it's unbelievable. And seeing the public sermon and declaration of a baptism, that's what it is. It's a sermon to the world. I died to my old self. I'm rising to new life. It's a beautiful thing. So it could be in this where you need to be baptized, but I don't think he's saying you need to be baptized to be saved. Of course he's not saying that, because you have people all through the Bible. You got the guy on the cross who says, you know, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus says, of course, you're saved. And the guy never gets baptized. Baptism isn't what saves you. It's what declares to the world that you're already saved. But we love it. We emphasize it because it's a beautiful image to the world, something Jesus told us to do, because there was no such thing as a believer in the first century that was unbaptized. And so there's a baptism image here, but it's probably not what he's talking about. I think what he's talking about is water symbolizes the word he uses here, not to get gross, but it's your first birth. It's you were in the fluid in your mom. And you had and there's a lot of fluid involved in giving birth. Ask the ladies. For you guys who are too wussy to go in, there's some water involved. And you have this natural birth about yourself, and that's not good enough. You need the spiritual birth. Your natural, so he's kind of reiterating what he's just said. And then, of course, there was something else I was thinking about. We just came from a story where water in the water to wine story represented phase one of salvation history. And now he's saying the Spirit is the phase two of salvation history. So you've got to come out of the one and Nicodemus who in your Jewish religious structures and actually be born of the Spirit. The point is that the Holy Spirit is given here as being born naturally or born just one time isn't enough. That's why verse 6, that which is born of the flesh is flesh. So maybe these two are kind of making the same point. And that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. And he's saying there's two parts of us actually. And this is, of course, debated among scholars about whether modern philosophy and psychology, if you're coming from a naturalistic perspective, would ever say that there's a spiritual part of us. Because he says, of course, S right here, small s. we are spiritual beings. But modern psychology has actually started to play with this idea that we are more, one psychologist I was reading recently, more than just our minds. Something else lies behind it. There's work being done on near-death experiences among people where they're starting to, people are, even from a naturalistic perspective, realizing that there's something about the spiritual realm that's a thing. You know, I find it fascinating that people are getting in touch with me with the opening story of my book, The Problem of Jesus, and there's all these kind of emails about, because it was the story about the demonic and experiencing something that literally there was a spiritual presence in my home. And people saying, I've had experiences like this that are extremely hard to explain. I know of one, there's two brothers who are Christians and they write and direct horror movies. And people are like, why would you direct horror movies? You're Christians, you're not supposed to do that, that's evil. And their whole philosophy is, yeah, because what am I just gonna do a movie about, I don't know, just living life and being good at education? You know, what other story should we tell? Rather than stories that crack open the question of whether there's something behind the veil. Why wouldn't I tell stories that are spiritual in nature to put it in front of our face? Because the reality is we are spiritual. And the question is not just, is there a natural world that you were born into? That's not good enough. You need to be born spiritually. And so you have to ask the question. Russell Moore, who's like the super conservative thinking guy in the United States, Christian guy, he says that his favorite holiday is Halloween. Now, you would think all the Christians are like, yeah, no, Halloween's bad. He's like, my favorite. And he said, growing up, Christmas was fine. You get the presents. But Halloween was the best because when I went out at night and I saw those skeletons and those zombies, I knew there was a reason I got afraid because it spoke to something that was real. And all we want to do is bury it. We don't want to talk about the spiritual. We just want to move on with our life. And what do you talk about with your friends? Anything spiritual? Or do you just talk about the latest vacation you're going to go on and what you're watching on TV and what did you bring for dinner? Stuff that doesn't matter eternally. Beautiful stuff. Stuff that has to do with the integration of our life. But is it spirit stuff? Stuff that's about your soul? Or is it stuff all in the temporal plane, the natural plane? This is why he's going, I showed my girls, my two older girls, Field of Dreams recently. I love it. And of course, it's the story about a guy who builds a baseball field and then ghosts start showing up. And I was talking to my oldest yesterday. I'm like, so did you like Field of Dreams? She's like, yeah. It's like, what's the point of it? What is it about? I'm like, well, ultimately, it's about this guy who did this thing with his dad and he regretted it. And so he gets to play catch with his dad again at the end. If you build it, he will come. Wasn't talking about shoeless shows, talking about his father. And every time, dad, you want to have a catch? And I bawl my eyes out. It's about these ghosts showing up out of a cornfield, but it ain't about that. It's about this crazy idea that there may be people, when they pass away, there might be something that continues about them. And could we ever risk the idea that that might be true? And Jesus is saying it is true. It's actually the most real and important thing about you, that you are spirit. And you have spiritual yearnings and pinings that nothing in this world can satisfy because you weren't made for this world. You were made for another kind of existence. And the only way to get that, you know it, when you look around, you pine and you yearn and nothing, not you get all the money, you get all the things, you get all the relationships, you're the boss and nothing satisfies you and you can't figure it out because there's something at a soul level that hasn't been filled yet. That's why he's saying, how would you possibly fill it? You fill the spirit with the spirit, meaning the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the answer to your longings. The Holy Spirit is God's answer to the longings of humankind all through history to connect to the transcendent, the pinings that never got fulfilled in all the stories and all the money and all the sexuality and all the success and all the power couldn't fulfill it. The Holy Spirit is the answer. And the question is, in your life, is this the forgotten God? As one writer has put it, we focus on the Father. Yep, there's God, there's Jesus. And then we're like the Holy Spirit. We're not really sure what to do with the Holy Spirit, right? We're like an academic or a sociologist at a Pentecostal church service. We're just like, well, we can explain this. And why is that guy, you know? And it's like, guys, wake up. The Holy Spirit is alive and well and moving and speaking and doing things with power. And Jesus is saying there's a kind of life on offer here that you can only access if you're drawn back to the end of yourself, the most humbling thing of all, and you say, I can't save myself. I need God to birth me. And it's his work, not mine. How much did you have to do with your first birth? It's called the doctrine of regeneration. Again, genesis, beginning. A re-beginning for you that comes about by the Holy Spirit of God through the person and the work of Jesus. But it has to become personal. It has to become a decision. We love, remember a couple of weeks ago, I talked about Abraham, my guide, guiding me around Israel, Jewish guy, awesome guy. And we went to the water and the wine. And I said, you know, and he said, I've never heard it described like that before. At one point in our conversation, I said, you know more about Jesus than almost any Christian I know, Abraham, because you do all these tours. It's unbelievable. But what do you think about the truth of what Jesus' words were? Meaning, you know the words. Now, what about the question of whether you actually think they're right or not? And he said, no, that's not for me. I'm comfortable for where I am, but thanks for asking. That's the Nicodemus problem. Jesus is going, I know you're comfortable. The question is, are you willing to experience a whole new thing, Nicodemus? And you watching, can you hear God speak? Can you hear him prompt you? Do you ever see stuff? You might know the Bible like Nicodemus, but he needed to come to know God. His problem wasn't lack of knowledge. It was the experience of the Spirit, conversion to the new way of salvation that Jesus and only Jesus was bringing, and the courage to go, I'm willing to submit myself to that. Because you could go to church, you could know the language and not know him. I saw this tweet about Judas the other day. It said this, Judas betrayed Jesus with a kiss. Someone's public affection for Jesus might not be telling the whole story. Let that shake us. So let me end with this. I love the passion I see in verse 4. How can a man be born when he's old? How can I go a second time into my mother's womb? He has a heart for God. He has a heart for heaven. He actually wants these questions answered. There's a passion here. One writer says this, I love this, and I'll leave it with all of us to think on about our own faith. He says, if I enter a place where there's a musical performance, my ticket entitles me to cross the threshold, but if I have no musical ear, I can have no enjoyment. In the same way, he says, if you have a right in something done for you that will warrant and enable you to cross the threshold to a relationship with God, if you have no heart prepared for their exercises and the joys of having it, it will be no happiness to you. What do you talk about in life? If your kids just watched you, what would they say you treasure above everything else in the world? If we sat them down and said, based on what mom and dad talk about, do, read, think, do with our money, do with our time, what do you think are the things we love the most? And don't guide them. Just let them answer. It's a scary question, right? You get access to something. I'm going to heaven when I die. But you don't even enjoy it. The eternal life given to you in the present. What is the greatest treasure? My fear is Christianity has become this tame, predictable thing in your life, and Jesus is here talking about the mystical, the spiritual, the power, the stuff you can't control. Are you ready to receive that adventure? The experiencing of God when he does crazy things and you can't really know what he's going to do and how he's going to do it, but there's a power in it, or you get all your religion and your God stuff all organized and these nice things, and it's like, hey, you're on my spiritual stuff and I don't want you touching the other things. And Jesus going, no, that's not salvation, man. That's being born once. It's not being born again. The way to be born again is to trust. He's going to go on the Son and what the Son does by the Spirit. Are you, the Bible, the New Testament's question about who a Christian is, when we go around and talk, who's a Christian? How do we define who a Christian is? You know what the New Testament's example is? A person who is defined by the Spirit of God. How did they get access to it? By believing in the Son. By trust, repenting of sin, becoming a child. So Father, I pray in this moment, there are people here asking that very question. People watching this asking this very question. How do I ever get saved? How do I come into the kingdom of God? How do I get eternal life? And this might be a moment right now where they say, I need to trust in Jesus' work on my behalf on the cross and in the resurrection for me, which I've never done. And if they do that, that they would literally, even in the chat right now where they're watching this, that they would just say, that's me. That's me. I want to trust Jesus. That's me. That's me. That's me. And then we would get in touch with them, or they would email us. That's me. Get me on the journey. I want to know that I have the Spirit of God in me. That's me. And that we would follow up well as a church, because this is the message of God's love. Being born once isn't enough. No matter what our heart is, if we're quote unquote good people, we're not evil people, it's not enough. It doesn't save us. You're making it very clear in this moment, Jesus, to everyone watching and listening to, we got to be born again by the Spirit. Do that work among us. Holy Spirit, we just pray that you would move everyone watching this, listening to this, that you would move and speak and create new life. That we would lean into it and not be afraid to rethink everything top to bottom in light of the truth of the work of the Holy Spirit in our hearts. In Jesus' great name we pray. Amen.